I was asked to speak about calm abiding. I was quite embarrassed. First, because I haven't developed calm abiding myself, so it's like a blind person speaking, you know, trying to show the way. However, I have practiced it for quite a number of years, so I have quite, some taste of it. Then the second thing that is a little bit an embarrassment is that here there's many people which study very hard and very extensively, and so probably they know more about calm abiding than I do myself, at least intellectually. And then there's plenty of text about how to develop calm abiding, starting from the great classics of India. Then we have in our tradition Lama Tsongkhapa's Lamrim Chenmo, which explains calm abiding very well. And then Pabongka's Liberation, which is considered the best explanation in the Gelug tradition. Another reason why I'm a little bit embarrassed to speak about calm abiding is that if you like it too much, you will leave the monastery and go into a hermitage, and then the abbot of the monastery would not be happy with me, right? So I have to be a little bit low-key about calm abiding. I have to tame my enthusiasm for it, no? Otherwise, I run into trouble. Can you hear me well enough? Or, yeah, okay, good. Now here there's an audience where some people study hard here at the monastery, and then there's people from outside which have a life in society. So it's quite two different needs or different level of interest. However, from my experience, to know how to calm down the mind, how to still the mind is very precious, regardless of what your activities are. You see, if one studies hard, sometimes one can go in an overdrive of intellectual reasoning and thinking, memorizing and thinking. And sometimes it's good to know how to stop it, how to stop the mind from thinking for a while and to experience some peace, some space. And then from that space one can then think again, you know, with a refreshed mind. So I think that's useful for people which study intensively. And then in society, often one is busy and has worry and responsibility. Then also the mind can go into this thinking, worrying about the future, thinking about the past and things like that. So this kind of restlessness. So to know how to bring the mind at peace, how to settle the mind, it's very useful. So, usually the main obstacle to calm abiding, the first one is not interest in the practice, or laziness, or procrastination. Right? So to overcome any of these three obstacles, the antidote is thinking about the benefit of calm abiding. So it's the thinking about the benefit of calm abiding will move your heart towards the interest of trying to put some effort into this practice. So in general, when our mind is very agitated, very restless, actually if one checked, that's not a happy state of mind, right? The mind is bubbling and boiling and, you know, agitated. So it's not so pleasant. So to be able to calm down the mind and rest it is very precious. Also, when your mind becomes still, you see, we think the only way of knowing is through thoughts, the intellect, the rational mind. But actually, there's another way of knowing. Within the stillness of the mind is once what we call intuition. No? So there's another way of knowing where you see directly things, not through the medium of thoughts and reasoning and analysis. So in spiritual practice, there's also a great emphasis to move from the head to the heart. You see, in Buddhism, one says that the secondary mind is in the head and the primary mind is in the heart. And in Tantra, the subtle mind of clear light is in the heart. One's most precious thing, one's core of being, one's essence is in the heart. So to be able to open the heart and to experience the stillness within it is so precious. No? And through calm abiding, one can slowly uncover, you see, the different layer of obscuration that constrict our heart, and to see our pure potential, our pure Buddha nature within it. No? If one wonders, you see, why I'm doing all this activity, going here and there, doing this and that, it's always because we want to be happy, and we think doing all these things will bring us happiness. However, real stable happiness is found within oneself. See, there's a spring in our heart of well-being, of bliss and joy and laughter, an infinite love within us, right? So we're always looking for happiness outside, but actually happiness is here inside. You know, if we go deep inside and let it uncover, reveal itself, you see, it's there. So calm abiding slowly makes allows you to go from the outer world, from the extroverted world, to look, to go in touch with what's inside. It's the bridge. You start looking inside and you become aware, you see, of your thought, of your worries, of your emotion thing. So you become mindful of what's going on. So that's very precious. You see, regardless whether you develop calm abiding or not, you see, the mere fact of training in it makes you much more conscious of what moves you, you know, why you do this and that. And whether you want to call it the soul or the subtle mind or, you know, or the basic mind or the... there is something in us which is, how to say, really the core of your being. And if you discover that, you have the experience, you see, that you have the feeling you have always existed and you will always exist. You see, the fear of death disappears because you go into touch with a level of your consciousness that you know, oh, that will always exist, you know. And it's so cozy, you feel, wow, it's like returning home. You know? So nice. And then as your level of calm abiding grows, there's some kind of a pleasant energy that starts growing in your body, a pleasant feeling. No? And that pleasant feeling, as your mind becomes stiller and stiller, that pleasant feeling grows. No? So it has a physical component and it has a mental component. And when your mind is stable and calm, if you have a question or something, you see, you ask a question, you think about what shall I do, where shall I go, you know, what shall I think about this and that. So you just ask the question and you stay in the stillness of your mind. And your mind becomes a little bit like the surface of water. You see, for us it's always agitated by thoughts. Right? So when you have the water that's fragmented at the surface, when something is reflected, it's always broken up in pieces, right? So it's the same thing with the mind. When your mind is still, it becomes like a mirror, and whatever you think of, you have a very clear intuition, you know? So your intuition becomes clearer and clearer as your calm abiding develops, as your mind becomes purer. And then you can, through experience, you can more and more trust your wisdom, you know, your inner wisdom. For example, Lama Yeshe used to say, the outer guru can only help you so much, you know. It can only help you so much. At some point, it's your inner guru that will lead you to enlightenment. So it's your inner wisdom, you see, that's become trustworthy, and that's what will lead you, you know, finally. And then for higher seeing, you see, you might think about this and that and have quite some good reasoning about reality and you know, understanding how things exist, how the eye exists, and so forth. But if you don't have a certain level of stability in your mind, you cannot even hold it. You know, so you cannot see all it implies. You just get flashes, but you cannot hold anything, and you cannot see all what it implies. So definitely, for higher seeing, for any genuine spiritual experience, without calm abiding, it becomes very difficult. You can have glimpses, you can have a strong emotion of love and compassion for a little while, but you cannot sustain it because your mind is not calm and clear enough, you know? Or you can get there and meditate on it with lots of effort. But at some point, it has to become effortless. And to become effortless, you need this stable, calm mind. And then if one wants to meditate on the graduate path of enlightenment, whether to realize the preciousness of the human life or impermanence, no karma, love, compassion, any spiritual realization, you need a mindfulness that is able to sustain it. You must be able to maintain that state of mind, whatever it is. Again, without a certain level of calm abiding, even the Lama Rima realization become impossible. You know, you can get there to the lines of reasoning, but you cannot sustain it. You cannot maintain it, right? So it cannot become effortless. You can get, you know, the effortful experience of that point of the lamrim, but it cannot become effortless because your mind is not stable enough. So for all these reasons, no, and then even in those who have interest in Tantra, again, without a certain level of calm abiding, it's very difficult to get any genuine experience that lasts. No, again, you can get some flashes of insight here and there, but again, no stability. So, developing a certain control over one's mind through calm abiding is useful in everyday life, is useful on the spiritual path, and then is useful on the higher level if one wants to get higher realization on the spiritual path, that's no question. And developing a certain level of calm abiding is not difficult. You see, as you will see, it's actually not difficult. It's just we don't have the interest of it, or we have other interests, so we don't have the discipline to work on it. So I hope to present tonight a little bit how to develop calm abiding, and we're going to train a little bit with different objects. Because basically one could develop calm abiding on just about anything. You can take a flower, you can take a candle, you can take your breath, you can take any image, you know, it doesn't matter in terms of calm abiding. So to start with, I'd like to chant some prayer. So why one does that? Usually in spiritual tradition, there's not only this level of this gross world with this, you know, there's not only us here, there are people which follow the spiritual path way before us and reach a level of realization where they have light energy bodies, you know, and their mind pervades everything, and they look on us with love and compassion, you know, without any partiality. So if one opens one's heart, you know, to these higher beings, definitely it helps us, you know, that when one hears teachings, when one contemplates and meditates, it has a stronger impact because one's heart mind is in a good place. You know, there's certain subtle level of vibration. If one has the right state of mind, just whatever one hears, thinks and reflects just has a deeper impact. There is something that, how to say, instead of listening, thinking through the ego, somehow the ego gets out of the way and one listens more with the heart, you know, more, you see, one is less judgmental, critical, analytical, and then things come in a different way and touches us in a different way. So usually there's many ways to go about it. You see, the main point is to open one's heart to a higher dimension. So, for example, is to have appreciation. You see, for those which have gone through the past before us. You see, for example, an enlightened being has tamed or our main teachers, you see, you can focus either on your main teacher or the Buddha. Tonight I'll focus on Lama Tsongkhapa since it's the main teacher of this tradition. So usually one reflects on the fact that that person has tamed his mind to ethic. You see, that person, all what he or she does, you see, it's always for the benefit of other and none out of selfishness. So it doesn't harm anybody. You know? And he has trained his mind to do that over a long, long, long time. And then that person has further tame his mind through the development of calm abiding. So the mind is not at all shaken up like ours. It's completely still and stable and able and doesn't have any mental disturbance like we have and experience inner bliss. And then they have further tamed their mind by seeing reality. See, they see everything as senseless. No? So everything is there while having no essence. So the mind doesn't have any more attraction and aversion. No? The mind is in total equanimity or equality towards all phenomena. And they have further trained their mind developing infinite love for all living beings. No? So they have developed that mind that sees each being in the same way as a loving mother sees her only child. So the Buddhas, the enlightened beings, they see us with that, you know, with that love. No? And then they have compassion for our problems, for our difficulties, you know. And they have the effortless, spontaneous wish to lead us to their state of realization. And then, if one looks from a tantric perspective, then they have realized, you see, the generation stage of imagining themselves as a light energy body of bliss and emptiness. And then on the completion stage, they have realized the clear light and illusory body as inseparable. So their mind pervades everything and they spontaneously manifest for us in any form that benefits us. See? So there are countless beings that have achieved that state. You see? So when one takes refuge or makes guru yoga, it's good to know what we open our heart to. You see, it's to that state, that realization. You know? And so the more you open your heart, you know, the more blessing or inspiration comes. And then there's some kind of experience of inner joy, inner peace, inner light. You know? So they often say how much progress or how quick our progress is, it depends on how much we're able to open our heart. It doesn't matter. You see, how much progress you make is not dependent on how much you know intellectually. It doesn't matter on this and that. It really depends on how much you open your heart. And you see, in any spiritual tradition, you know, whether the Christian mystic, the Sufis, you know, the Hindu master, one thing they have in common is this incredible devotion. You know? Why? Because devotion opens your heart. And as your chakra open up, you experience your more subtle mind of clear light. Right? And it's in that dimension that spiritual realization actually happens. You know? So, see, focus on what you believe, you know, is your image of enlightenment or of purity or of perfection. And those which like can focus on Lama Tsongkhapa as the embodiment of all the Buddhas and as inseparable from their own spiritual teacher. You know, the main point is not the visualization, it's the feeling that of the qualities these beings have, right? And requesting from the heart to get those qualities oneself, that they help us to gain those qualities. So first we're going to offer to them the short mandala, and then we're going to chant the Mitsema 3 times together while receiving the blessing from Lama Tsongkhapa or the space of goodness, or you just relax. The main point, you see, is to see, look, they were one day as confused as we were. They were our bodies, we were playing together, we make silly things together, and now, and that was countless time, lifetime ago. And meanwhile, they somehow became Buddha, and we not. You know? So it's to those beings which made it, you know, that we have, in our heart we have respect and admiration, and we aspire, you know, to become like them. So we open our heart to this higher being and to this space of goodness. Imagine from the space of goodness, light energy comes and enters into your body. Or for those which do Guru Yoga, can absorb the Guru Lama Tsongkhapa into their heart, and then they contemplate, you know, this space of light energy within their heart.
All right.
So calm abiding is about discovering this inner stillness of the mind. So to get to the discipline of wanting to develop this calmness of the mind, the first obstacle, as I said before, is not interest or laziness or procrastination. So the only way to turn your mind towards calm abiding is to remind yourself of the benefit. Oh, it would be nice if I develop a certain level of calm abiding. You know, it would be nice, you know, if I train my mind to have a calm mind. So that's the only thing that will move you to actually do it, right? Then the second thing is then to find an object that suits you, you know, an object that you like. So usually there are many objects explained in a tradition. I'll explain a few and then we're going to try three objects tonight. So I explain a little bit how it's going to proceed. And then we are going to do a few sessions of 5 minutes of meditation. You see, experiencing with different objects. Then you can see the different effect it has on your mind if you choose this object or that object or that object. And then to see how to proceed. You see, calm abiding is just it's a method. You see, it's like any sport, you know, there's a method, there's a way to go about it. And if you do it properly, it's not actually that difficult, no? So, of course, how much progress one makes depends on one's lifestyle. You see, if one has a lot of stress or worry or responsibility, it's more difficult. You know? Whereas if one has a more calm life, you know. So especially what they say, one requirement is a little bit to have some kind of ethic, you know, some kind of moral discipline, you know, of trying to avoid harming others. Because that would, you know, we would think about it, you know, have regret or, you know, a thought about it that would distract us. So then once you sit down for your actions, you decide, oh, now I want to sit for 5 minutes, you know. So you sit on your cushion and usually one observe the breath for a few minutes just to calm down the mind from what one did just before and what one does after. So one lets settle the mind a little bit. And then the next very important point is to make a determination. You see, now for 5 minutes I'm going to do this. So 5 minutes I'm going to watch the breath. So it's like, you see, if you have to wake up the next morning at 5 o'clock, let's say. So if you have the determination in your mind, tomorrow morning I have to wake up at 5 and you don't have an alarm clock, somehow, naturally you wake up at 5. And that's the power of determination. So the first power that you rely on to actually stick on your object of observation is the power of determination. Now for 5 minutes I'm going to watch the breath. And I'm not going to think about what I'm doing after or my shopping list or whatever. You know, for 5 minutes, I'm going to focus on this and nothing else. And after 5 minutes, I can think of whatever I want. But for 5 minutes, I'll gently rest my mind on that object and I won't let it go away from it. You see, calm abiding is about gently taming your mind. So you cannot be too harsh with your mind. The mind would rebel. It's like if you have a naughty child. If you're too harsh, you cannot tame that child. You know, he will just become more crazy. So you have to be very gentle with your mind. You know. So we Westerners, when we hear the instruction about calm abiding, we're too strong. We put too much effort. And for example, Sogyal Rinpoche, which has dealt with Westerners for many, many years, he says, actually, when I tell Westerners to focus on the object, now I tell them, just with 20% of your attention, you know, not with your whole mind, because Westerner, they concentrate too strongly, and then it shakes the mind. So just with 20% of your attention, you're happy, you know, we're just like that. Because, you see, so with the determination, said, now for 5 minutes, I'm going to focus on the breath. Right? So then the next power, after the strength of determination, or the force of determination, or the power of determination, whatever you want to call it, you know, that strength of mind. So the next thing that you try to develop is the mind, a mindfulness that with one part of the mind doesn't let go of the object. That's your main job, you see? So you focus on the breath. You can have other thoughts, other things going on, but one part of your mind stays on the breath. See, one part of the mind, you don't let it be distracted. And that's good enough. Once you're able with one part of your mind to not let go of the object, then gradually you take a little bit, from 20% you go 30% and 40% of your attention, then 50%, then 60%. And like that, gradually you hold the object with more and more of your attention. But to start with, if you do that too quickly, the mind is shaken. You put too much energy, and then you get exhausted, you get tired, and you have no energy, and you might think you make quicker progress, but then you make progress, and then you fall back and things like that. So you make simply too much effort. You're not gentle enough with the process. And then once you're able to, with one part of your mind, to hold the object for the whole duration of the session, let's say 5 minutes, right? With the whole time you can hold with one part of your mind. Then you develop another power of the mind, which is called introspection. So you're able to have a witness from time to time. You check how you hold on to how your main mind is faring, how you're holding your object. Are you too tight? Are you too loose? So like that. And then once you have seen, you see, what is too tight or to you, then the next power or strength of mind is applying antidote. So it's strengthening the mind if it's too loose, or relaxing if it's too intense. And that's how, you see, you progress. And then later on, when your mind has the right pitch, you know, the right level of attention, and you still keep on changing the your holding of the object, you know, you tighten, you loosen, tighten, when it's no more necessary. So at that point, you have to apply the antidote of no more interfering. You see, then you just have to let go. So you don't apply any more antidotes. So, we're going to do a small 5 minute session, right? So we're going to use the breath as an object. So the breath, you see, the Buddha explained the breath as one of the best objects, especially for people which have delusion or mental affliction of many different types. So it's an antidote to all the mental affliction, to all the disturbance. So the breath is considered one of the best objects in that sense. So no matter what type of delusion you have, the breath takes care of it. And then the breath, you can observe it at the level of the nostril. You see the entering and leaving of the air at the nostril. Or you can observe the whole movement of the breath, inhaling, holding a little bit, 1 or 2 seconds, then exhaling, inhaling. So the whole movement of the breath. Or you can focus at the belly, you know, down there. And some people which have some level of understanding of, can focus on the atum, you see, at the navel. So again, very gently, you see, you breathe in, you hold a little bit, and you exhale, and you keep your focus down there for finger width level below the the belly button. No? So that method was one of the favorite of Lama Yeshe. So in the Koppan course, you see in the morning, we would do that meditation. Inhale, hold it a bit, and exhale while focusing, you know, below the belly button, but closer to the spine. So Lama Yeshe found that one very helpful because in Tantra, if you your subtle wind energy is more focused on the central channel. So the disturbance in Tantra is explained because the wind energy flows in the side channel. So if you're able to focus your mind more in the central channel, you will have, if you bring more and more your wind into the central channel, then less and less thoughts and disturbance you will have. So for this session, please decide, you know, oh, I'm going to focus on the nostril, or I'm going to focus on the whole movement of the breath, or I'm going to focus down at the atom. And then you say, why? Because I have to learn to calm down the mind. Because an agitated mind is an unhappy mind. A peaceful mind is such a pleasant state of mind to be in. And I aspire to develop that capacity. Then you make the mental determination. Now for 5 minutes, I'm going to focus on this and that aspect of the breath. And I won't let my mind be distracted by it. At least one part of my mind will stay there. And then you gently put your mind on that object. So you become intimately intimately connected with the object. You see, you try to remove the gap of subject and object. You become the breath. So you gently go there and you try to become one with your object of observation. So you have to like your object. You have to want to be one with the object. And that is very helpful. Then you gently breathe. You see, with much love and care, with enjoying the process. And now for 5 minutes, you're going to focus on that and not let our mind be distracted. see in this process, this many things one become aware of is first we have a body, and so you have also to take care of your body when you do meditation. So you have to put yourself in a position that is comfortable before you start. You see, so you have, and then usually you move your body a bit, you see, to remove the stiffness here and there. And then sometimes it's helpful to make a scanning of the body from head to toe or toe to head to remove all the tensions in the joints, you see, between the all the joints. Actually, there's some muscles which hold it quite tight. So if you completely relax your body, all the joints, you know, all the muscles that hold your spine here and there, the muscles of your face and things. So if you relax your body, there's a feeling of ease that comes with it. So if your body is completely relaxed, your mind also becomes more relaxed. And as you progress in the minutes of your sessions, you see, if you sit for half hour or longer, so then from time to time you scan your body because tension starts accumulating here and there. You see, because you make some effort to hold on to the object, so there's some kind of tension, you see, in your shoulder or in your face or somewhere in your body. So if you scan and relax those tension within your body, you can actually sit much longer and your concentration is much better. You see, because the body tension affects your mind, creates tension in your mind, and the tension of your mind creates tension in your body. So if you're able to be attuned, you see, from time to time to check how your body is doing, it really helps your mind, your concentration. And then as you see now, when you hold your mind onto the object, is that the mind tends to move, right? Wanting to go away and also become more dull. You see, it's either the mind becomes too tight or too loose. So it's the way you deal with the attention is very much like tuning a guitar. You tighten your mind, you hold on to it, you loosen it, you tighten, you loosen, till you find exactly the right pitch. Right? But the right pitch for a farmer is different than the high pitch of a surgeon. Right? Because the hands, you know, are used to work with heavy things, so the hands are not so finely tuned, right? Whereas a surgeon that does or a scientist which does, you know, microscopic experience, his fingers are very finely tuned, you know, for this kind of work. So it's same thing with our attention. You see, at the beginning, our mindfulness is quite rough. So holding on to the object, good enough, you know. But as you progress, you're able to finely tune it, you see. So first what you remove is gross dullness, gross sleepiness, and gross distraction. And once you reach at the fourth, fifth level, you don't have any more gross distraction and gross dullness. Then what you deal it is with subtle. Then you become aware that actually, okay, you're able to hold on to the object, but while holding the object, there's still some movement in the mind, and there's still some subtle dullness. So there you start removing those obstacles. But at the beginning, to deal with this more subtle level, it just becomes a distraction. So one has to go gradually and be happy with just having one part of the mind on the object. And once you get to this level of comfort, where you know with one part of the mind you don't lose it, then you hold it a little bit tighter, a little bit tighter, a little bit tighter, like that. So at the beginning, Yushiwan says one of the main obstacles to get full calm abiding is subtle sinking, you know, subtle dullness. But that's when you reach the 7, 10, 8 level. At level 1, actually, subtle dullness can be quite helpful, you know. To be subtly, you know, comfortable, cozy, and having less thought is actually helpful, you know. Then from that side, so it's better to be a little bit on subtle dullness side than subtle excitement, you know, than gross excitement at the beginning. Then later on, when you reach 7, 8, so it's the opposite. Then it's better to lean towards subtle excitement than subtle sinking. Because subtle excitement you can recognize is easier to recognize than subtle dullness. But that's very advanced, so we don't need to worry about that at all, you know, for the time being. So for those which have the body a little bit uncomfortable, if they want to stand up 1-2 minutes and move their body, please do it. Then we do another session. So it's important to be able to sit comfortably, you know, with no pain, you know, like that. So I'll do a second one with that object of the breath. In the long term, it's good to have always the same object for calm abiding, because that object, you start knowing it more and more and more, so it becomes easier and easier. It's like going on the same track, you see? So you become so familiarized with it that it becomes very easy, you know? It's like, or like entering a tunnel, you know, you always go the same path down the way, right? So usually one sits comfortably, you know, move a little bit the body, and then remember, you know, how wonderful it would be if I had calm abiding, you know, if my mind would settle still, you know, without agitation, without distraction, without dullness, and could remain there without effort. That would be fantastic, you know. Whatever level of intuition would result, it would help all my other meditation. You know, I could really contemplate on any things and get insights, because I would start from this still part of my mind. No? So I would use my thoughts and think about it and could rest at the conclusion and really stare on that experience. So for all these reasons, to develop calm abiding is so precious. So I'm going to do a 5-minute session now. Then you decide, I'm going to focus here and here, either at the nostril or the whole breath or at the navel. Then you make the determination, now for 5 minutes I'm going to hold that object without letting the mind go. So you make a strong determination. It's like almost like you see, with your fist you hold something, a flower or something, you know, a stem. You know, I'm holding it, I'm not going to let it go for 5 minutes. So you develop a mental muscle. You see, that now for 5 minutes I'm not going to let go. So with your mental muscle, you kind of squeeze your object, you know, not too much and not too little. So mentally there's a little tension there, right? And with that little tension, you hold your object. And you won't let it go for 5 minutes. You see, what's happening in the body when you develop a calm, still mind is that there is a certain level of tension there, but it's a tension that comes about the polarization of the energy in your body. Is that when you have a wire that is not polarized, the electron move in any direction. And when it's polarized, all the electrons go in one direction. So with calm abiding, as your mind becomes focused, that focus realigns the energy in your body. So your energy, which is kind of loose, becomes realigned like that. So your energy becomes aligned, and that alignedness creates a physical and mental well-being. So it's due to your concentration realigning the energy within your body-mind. And that produces, as a side effect of that alignment, is a pleasant sensation arising. So that pleasant sensation will not arise if you hold the mind too loose. See, so you need to have a certain level of tension, mental tension there, for that alignment to take place. But if you hold it too tightly, too soon, then that produces stress, tiredness, tension, lung, and so forth. So it's not productive. But gently you have to tighten, 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 and then gradually you see, you know, these things happening in your body, mind. So the main key is this development of mindfulness that holds an object continuously, you see, without letting it go. So that's the main key. You see, if you speak about the ninth stage of calm abiding, at level one, if you meditate 10 minutes, for more than 5 minutes, your mind is wandering away. So you're not able to have any sustained attention for any duration for very long, right? So at level two, if you meditate 10 minutes, more than 5 minutes, you can actually stay on the object. But you still have periods where you lose the object, you start thinking about your shopping list or what you're going to do after or what that person told you before the session or so forth, right? So at level three, so during 10 minutes, most of the time you're able to sustain the attention. Just from time to time you lose it, but your power of attention is so strong that when you lose it, it just makes a loop. You're able actually to bring it back. Because your level of not forgetting is so strong that if the mind loses, you bring it back, right? So that's level three. At level four, if you decide for 10 minutes, now I'm going to stay on the object, for 10 minutes you're going to stay. You know, so you have developed the power of the mind that won't let go the object for the whole duration of the 10 minutes, you know. And when you reach that, the danger is that you become complacent. You see, you made quite some effort to get there. You know, you meditated for many hours to get to that level where you can, where part of your mind doesn't forget the object. So suddenly you have this feeling, oh, now I'm there, so you kind of relax a bit. You know, you know you're not going to lose it now for 10 minutes, so you relax. Oh, nice, now I can meditate, you know. Now, you know, whatever you want, you stay on it, you know, for the whole duration. Yes, there's subtle agitation, you know, there's subtle thinking, but the main part of your mind actually stays the whole duration, and you're kind of happy. So you start knowing that you can multitask, you know, you can meditate and think about something else at the same time, right? So then you have to take care of this multitasking, you know. So usually they speak about, it's like water moving under ice, you know. So the main part of your mind is the ice, you know, stays on it. But there's water moving under it, you know, this bubbling, so you can hear it, you know. So you can hear the thoughts there at the surface, but you down there, you know, kind of like that. So there at the fourth level, what you have to do is to remove this subtle dullness there, this subtle, sinking. You see, the mind has sunk a little bit too much inside, so you have to tighten the hold of the object. You see, there you have to bring the mind to improve a little bit the level of your concentration. You hold it a bit tighter with your mental muscles. And as a result of that, you start experiencing bliss. Right? So it's at the fifth level that you start experiencing the benefit of calm abiding. You start experiencing mental and physical well-being while you meditate. And it's due to this alignment of the energy in your body-mind. You know, that tension starts producing a pleasant sensation, right? So at the fifth stage, so that physical and mental well-being will increase till you have full calm abiding. So from the fifth stage on, you start having the benefit of calm abiding, and it will continually to grow, you know, increase. So at the fifth, you see, you hold the object tighter to remove the subtle dullness. So you bounce back to the other side, subtle excitement, right? So then, you see, at the sixth level, you have to take care of the subtle excitement. So you have to use introspection to actually go back and forth between the subtle excitement and subtle sinking, you see. And at the seventh level, you are able actually, you see, your introspection is so strong that as soon as subtle excitement, subtle sinking arrives, you're able to counteract it, you see. Before, you might have been aware of it, but you weren't able to counteract it, you see. Or sometimes you would and sometimes you wouldn't, you know. But at the seventh, you don't let it pass, you know. Subtle excitement, so singing, yeah, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Right? So you're able to stay there. And at the eighth level, at the beginning of the session, you have to make this effort, you see, to remove subtle excitement, subtle sinking. But then it's a free ride. You know, at the eighth level, after 5-10 minutes in the session, you can completely relax, and there's no more subtle movement of the mind, subtle excitement, or subtle sinking. So, eighth level, then it becomes, you know, very, very pleasant. And then at the ninth level, there's no more effort. You sit down, you focus on your object, there's no more, you go in a deep silence. A deep silence, deep bliss, deep well-being. You know, there's no more effort, you know. There at the ninth level, you just have to sustain your practice to get to the actual calm abiding, you know. So it's good to know a little bit the process ahead. It's good also to recognize which level of calm abiding you are at. Because at each level you have a specific obstacle and a specific antidote. Right? At level 1 and 2, you're not able to have any sustained attention. So there the force you rely on is to think about the benefit of calm abiding. You know, or have, you know, because they speak about calm abiding. Where is the calmness? Thank you so much, you know. You know, it's not possible, you know. Well, you speak about something that doesn't exist. So it's only by remembering the benefit that actually, you know, you know, and thinking, oh, I have to continue, you know. But meditation is work, is not pleasant at level 1 and 2. It's quite a struggle. Right? Even level 3 is quite a struggle, although you start being able to maintain something. You know? At level 4, it starts being nice. You know. So at level 1 and 2 is the force of your aspiration for calm abiding. Level 3 and 4 is the power of your mindfulness that gets fully developed. So it's true to you sustain that tension you get to through level 3 and 4, right? And then 5, 6 is due to your introspection, Five, six, seven is the development of introspection and the quality of introspection. And then it's just continuing the practice. Now, I would like to do another object just to introduce it. So you see, for some people the breath, the advantage is that you always breathe and it's easy to find as an object, right? You don't need to look for the breath, it's there, right? So another object is to take a mental image, you see, of let's say the Buddha or any inspiring being, you know. So the advantage of that is you cultivate that focus on that being. So it's not a neutral object like the breath. It's a positive, virtuous object. So all the time you focus on the Buddha, you put the imprint of the Buddha in your mind. You see, you become closer to the Buddha. You become closer to the Buddha state. And that imprint, you see these hours of meditation on the Buddha, then when you get sick or you have problem, it's easier to remember the Buddha because you have trained your mind, you see, to focus on it. And then when you die, you see, easy to recollect the Buddha. You know, in the bardo, easy to remember the Buddha because you have spent all these hours. You see, you develop that habit, that mental memory, you see, of the Buddha. So it's very beneficial to take the image of a Buddha, and it can be as front generation or those which practice Tantra as self-generation. You know, either way, it's okay. You know? So there, on top of the tools I explained, there's a little bit some more tools that you get involved when you use a mental image. So you could also take the image of your mom or your child or whatever, you see. It doesn't matter. In terms of calm abiding, it doesn't depend on the object. However, if you take an object of attachment as your object of calm abiding, your attachment would grow, intensify, right? So it's better to take a virtuous object, you know, a spiritual object, right? So in Buddhist tradition, usually one take an aspect of the Buddha, but it could be Chenrezig, it could be Tara, it could be any form of Buddha that we, you know, we feel some kind of heartfelt connection. So some of us, you see, you have familiarity with that image for so long that you just close your eyes and you have it there. For other people, it's good to take a picture. You know, you're taking picture in front of you and you look at the picture and then you try to create a mental image of that picture in your mind. So here, see, you have Shakyamuni Buddha in front of you. For those which don't have a mental image, they can look at Shakyamuni Buddha for a little while and then create a mental image of it in your head. And then you spend a minute scanning the image of the Buddha. You see, from head to toe, you say, oh, this is crown protrusion, and then this curly hair, and then the eyes are like that, and the nose like that, the mouth like that, and the chin, and the shoulder, and then the robes, and then the knees are like that, lotus posture, the hand like that. So you scan a little bit. And then you do calm abiding. You hold the blurred image of whatever you can. You don't analyze anymore. You don't look here, this, that. You just keep a blurred image of the whole form. And you're happy with that. You see, what you try to gain first is stability. And once you have stability, you look for clarity. And once you have clarity, then you would look for intensity later on. So the first stage is just stability. So you don't worry, you don't look where, you know, how he looks like in detail. You scan first and then you hold for 5 minutes that blurred image, you know, that fuzzy image of whatever your mind can hold on to. So let's try to do that for 5 minutes. You can look at the Buddha in front or any mental image you already have, or self-generation for those who like. And then you hold that, you scan a little bit, and then you hold whatever is there. There's another object that can be interesting. So there's many aspects how to develop the capacity to visualize and how to develop calm abiding on a mental image. There's also the fact that you can visualize it heavier or lighter, brighter. So all these can help to remove dullness or agitation. But we would need more time that we have here tonight. It's just another object I would like to introduce is the space-like nature of awareness. Because for many of us, we have a lot of thought, a lot of agitation. So to be able to rest in the space-like nature of the mind is very relaxing, is very comfortable. And it removes the busyness of the mind. It helps you then to understand the mind. So to be able to rest in a space like nature of the mind is very, very helpful for many things. First of all, it's the base then to do Mahamudra type of practice, where you look where the thought comes from, where they abide, where they go, what's the nature of the thoughts. You see, you realize that they're the same nature as the mind. So you reach a point where the thoughts, whether they are thoughts or no thoughts, is the same for you. You know, they don't distract you anymore. They don't agitate you anymore. You see them like rainbow energy, you know. So then your mind is naturally settled, you know, in its own nature. It's very, very helpful. Also, you see, we get hypnotized by thoughts, ideas, concepts. So sometimes to focus on the gap between thought, you see, instead of focusing on the content of the mind, you focus on the space of the mind, the nature of the mind itself, its clear and knowing aspect. So somehow, because you don't focus on the thought, you don't cultivate thought, it creates some space and you're able to relax, to let go, you know? And then rest in the nature of the mind. So this is a very helpful as a side effect. You start seeing things as kind of transparent, you know. Things appear because, you see, not because you see it's the ultimate nature of thing, but because you focus on space, you see. Then when you look at phenomena, they appear spacious as well, you know. So there's a spaciousness, a lightness in your mind, instead of being suffocated by concept, idea, being rigid about your thought, your ideas about what's good, what's bad, what should be done, what should not be done, and, you know, all these ideas. Somehow, when you're able to relax in space like nature of the mind, much more spacious. It's very helpful for that. Then, of course, then it's the ground for higher seeing. You see, in Mahamudra, would first stabilize the conventional nature of the mind, to understand that, hold that. And then within that, without shaking that mind, one would then use little reasoning, little thought, and then go to the ultimate nature of the mind or the eye. Get insight into that. But because the starting point is the space-like nature of the mind, that space-like nature of the mind is less dualistic subject and object, right? So you get quicker to some kind of non-dual insights. So there's many different techniques, you know, in all the many lamas and many traditions have different techniques to recognize the space-like nature of the mind. So it's an object that is slightly more difficult to find for some people. And for other people, it's quite easy. They like that. You know? So usually when I lead retreats, I introduce that object also. And then usually 1/3 of the people, they feel very comfortable with the space-like nature of the mind, and they take that as an object. You know? You see, while you sit here, there's a space between your eye and the object you see. So your eye consciousness can focus on that space in front of you, you know. And there's a space between your ear and the sound that you hear. So you rest your mind in that space, that gap. And there's some space around your body that you can feel with your body consciousness. You know, you can feel the temperature of the room. And in your mind there's space between the thoughts. So you focus on that space. Then whatever feeling of space, you try to become one with it. Instead of looking at the space, you become the space. Of course, you would alternate that at the beginning with being clear about your object of focus. So you're not spacing out. You're focusing on the clear and knowing aspect of consciousness. So you would try to recognize it. That thing that has no form, no color, no shape, that doesn't abide anywhere, and that is clear in a sense that it doesn't obscure or impede anything from arising, and it's being known, it is being cognized. So, and then when you show that you're focusing on that space, then you hold on to that spaciousness. And you relax in it, you become one with it. And And then you start realizing that the thoughts, mental image, emotion arise out of that space, are in the nature of that space, and dissolve back into that space. So thoughts, emotion, mental image are non-event. All right, time is passing, and I think I was just able to introduce a little bit the topic. Actually, one would need much more time to actually explore any of these things in any level of depth experientially. So, if you have any questions, now we have a few minutes left. So if you have any questions about what I said, I'll try to answer. So one thing is sure is that you're not able to maintain the same quality, same intensity as if you're in retreat. What I notice is that once you get the conditions back, let's say after 6 months or a year or 2 years, very quickly you go back to where you were before. You know how to get there. And your mind's muscles know how to get there. So very easily you go back to your level of concentration you had before. How much you're able to sustain while doing other activities, I think it completely depends of your type of activities and how much you're able. Because actually, for calm abiding, what's important, it's very interesting, is not the quantity, it's the quality. So it's better to do 5-10 minutes often than to do a half hour and 1 hour. Better to, if you have 1 hour time, better to do 6 sessions of 10 minutes throughout the day, than to do 1 hour. You get more benefit because somehow you're able to maintain it throughout the day. Yes? I'm sorry, I don't know. You see, when I lead retreats, it's very interesting. Usually I lead a 10-day, 2 weeks retreat. And at the level, at the beginning we checked, which level people are. And usually they are between 1 and 4. Some people start at level 4, right? Some people have concentration quite naturally. So it's due to their profession, due to their sport or their activity or musician. Some people, due to their profession, have quite a good level of concentration. So we don't start all at the same level. But within 10 days of doing calm abiding retreat, most people go to between level 4, 5, 6. So you can make very quick progress to I think then it becomes more challenging. Is to remove gross excitement and gross thinking is not that difficult. It's the subtle one that are difficult. The subtle thinking and the subtle excitement. There it becomes quite challenging. So usually people within 10 days, if they were level 2, they get to level 4. Those which were level 3, they get level 5. Those which were level 4 can get level 6. You know, so within 10 days, 2 weeks of doing calm abiding retreat, you're in the right setting, in a group retreat, you know, so you can quickly. Then, of course, you leave back and you go back to your daily life, you're not able to sustain it. That's the difficulty. But it gives the people, the participant, the feeling, oh, I can do it. You know, if I have the right condition, I can do it. So it gives some kind of self-confidence. You see, self-esteem. Oh, I can do it if I put myself in the right conditions. No, so it's kind of helpful for that mind, for that. Yeah. Yes.
When and where will you conduct your next
retreat? Maybe in 2 weeks in California. Yes. So there in California, lead a 10-day retreat on calm abiding and Mahamudra.
No.
In Europe hasn't happened yet. Yeah. It depends, you see, the object, and it depends the people. So, for example, for Mahamudra, for the space agnetti of the mind, there is tradition where actually you keep the eyes open and you focus on the gap, on the space you see around you. So that space is the same as the space of your mind. So it kind of it helps you to recognize space. And also you don't get distracted by your thoughts, because you have the eye open, so your eye consciousness overpowers your mental consciousness, so it's easier to go into a meditative state, right? So, and then for visualization, sometimes it's easier also to visualize with your eye open. The Dalai Lama often says even he sees a difference of quality if he keeps his glasses on or not. So definitely, the mind at the beginning is better to have the eyes open, because you don't get distracted by your thoughts so much. Right? Then later on, it doesn't matter so much, really. Because what happens as your concentration grows, your mind withdraws from the sense consciousness. So you don't hear so well, you don't see so well. You know, your mind is so focused on the mental consciousness that your sense consciousness is some kind of withdrawn. So whether your eyes are open or not, anyway, you don't see really, you know. So it doesn't really matter. There's different tradition within that. So usually those which in the Theravada tradition or a certain branch of the Theravada tradition that take the breath at the nostril. So it's not that the breath ceases. It's that what happened is that because the concentration grows, it's actually, instead of focusing on the physical sensation, you focus on the mind there, right? And while focusing on the mind there, there seems to be some squiggle of light happening in your mind. So you take this squiggle of light as the object of calm abiding. So the breath is still there, but you start focusing on the mental, on the mind there, because anyway it says you cannot develop calm abiding on a physical, it has to be a mental object. So even they in calm abiding, they would focus on the mind there, right? But they start with the physical sensation and then it turns into the mind being there. You know, they lose the attention on the physical sensation. I'm not sure, because they don't speak about 9 stages, they have a different classification of things. No? So it's I would say it's quite advanced level where that would happen. What you do between the sessions is a very good question, yes. So if you do retreat, it's different than if you do calm abiding a little bit in your daily life, right? So if you do retreat, basically it becomes your main thing, right? So basically, if you do calm abiding retreat, they say if you have all the good condition, you can get it within 6 months or a year, right? But nowadays, it's difficult to get the outer and inner condition to get it. No. But in the old days, they would say you can get it within 6 months. So they would allow you not to do your commitment during that time. So even you would, you know, you would stop your commitment. You would only do shine. So basically, in the break time, you would continue with part of your mind, hold the object. You would just relax your body and go back. No. So you would just rest for, you know, going to the bathroom, eating and sleeping. The rest of the time would be only calm abiding. And like that you could get it within 6 months or a little bit more. No? But for us, so for the lamas, what they advise us, you know, if we do calm abiding, first you keep your commitment, you know, things like that. And gradually as your concentration grows, you reduce your commitment. You know, so as your concentration grows, as you see more progress, you know, as you are able, you know. So let's say you would do your commitment, you know, 2 hours in the morning and maybe an hour at night, and the rest of the day you would do calm abiding, you know. And then gradually even that you would reduce these things. So there's not really, there would be no more real break. No, so it's not like you can read. So they say you cannot read a book. You know, you cannot study. You know, so it's not. If you aim to get calm abiding, that's your goal of your retreat. Then that's your only focus. You know, during that time. So one accumulates merit before, purify obscuration, and you know, create all the condition before. No, so for example, in Lama Tsongkhapa's tradition, calm abiding is explained quite late in the spiritual path, in the Lamrim, in the graduate path to enlightenment. And he explains why. He says, you see, if you have a realization of devotion, of preciousness of human life, impermanence and death, love, compassion, so all these experience you have of the path to enlightenment, they become antidote to the obstacle you face in calm abiding. You know, so if you depress, you low, you remember, oh, I have Buddha potential, you know, I have Buddha nature, you know, things like that. And if you get agitated, you remember the suffering nature of cyclic existence or impermanence, and that it brings down the mind. So he says, it's the Lamrim experience help you actually to develop calm abiding. You know? So it's not, you see, when an obstacle arises in calm abiding, it's not the time to study and to find the antidote. You already know the antidote from before, right? So you're able to take care of your mind due to your, you know, your life of practice, basically. Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. Comment tu fais? Tu vois, tu le gardes une image mentale?
Oui.
À quelle distance?
Il n'y a pas de distance. Vraiment, à ce niveau.
À quelle taille?
Très petit.
Très petit. Voilà, comme ça. Et puis si tu bouges les yeux, est-ce que l'objet il bouge? Donc si tu bouges les yeux en focalisant sur l'image mentale, l'objet ne bouge pas. Pourquoi je mentionne ça? Le danger avec ça, c'est que tu ne focuses pas avec la conscience mentale, mais avec la conscience visuelle. Et une des façons de voir si tu médites avec la conscience mentale, c'est de bouger les yeux. Si tu bouges les yeux et l'objet ne bouge pas, ça veut dire que tu focuses avec la conscience mentale. If bouger les yeux fait bouger l'objet, ça veut dire que tu focuses avec la conscience visuelle. Donc ça, c'est un des trucs. Voilà. So in English for those, yeah. So she was saying that she focuses on a mental image, on a Buddha here, and then I asked her whether the Buddha moves, if she moves her eyes. And because you see the danger with mental images, which happened to many yogis, is actually you don't focus with the mental consciousness, but with the visual consciousness. You see, because with the eyes you look at the image and then you look it up. So the eye consciousness is involved. So if you move your eyes and the mental image and the image doesn't move, it means that you focus with the mental consciousness, and that's okay. If the object moves, then it's not good because you focus with the eye consciousness. Tu parles de stress. De nouveau, ça dépend de la tension que tu as. Il faut apprendre le bon niveau de tension que tu as en l'objet. Tu vois. Donc, si tu es trop tendu, ça va créer de la tension dans ton corps, dans ton esprit. Et puis, tu vas pas pouvoir maintenir la concentration très longtemps. Tu vois. Puis, si tu es trop relax, l'esprit ne va pas être très clair. Donc, c'est cet apprentissage de trouver la bonne pression mentale sur l'objet. Voilà. Ok, je crois que ça suffit pour aujourd'hui. Donc, ce développement du calme mental, de la stabilité intérieure, aussi rend très facile le développement du bon cœur, d'une attitude bienveillante envers autrui. I'm sorry. So, the training in calm abiding, you see, to get to the stillness of your heart, of your being, makes it very easy to be gentle with yourself and gentle with others. You know? And that gentleness makes your life more and more easy. You see, I practice now since 40 years, almost 40 years, 35. And if there's one quality that I appreciate more and more is the loving kindness, you know, to be a kind-hearted person. It makes life so easy. You know, wherever you go, you're comfortable. It's so cozy to have a kind mind, you know, not to be judgmental with others, not to argue, not to fight, to be patient and tolerant and to understand other people's problem, you know, and instead of judging, you know, just being compassionate and loving. So I think that's the spiritual quality that's most precious and is easy to practice in everyday life. You know, you don't need to be in retreat. And if you have a kind heart, loving heart, you easily keep a good ethic, you know, and easy to be generous and kind, helpful to others. So easy to get a good rebirth. You know? So, by the way, even if you don't believe in next life, even if you don't believe in rebirth, even if you don't believe in this and that, if you make your kind heart, loving kindness, you mean, spiritual dish, it will take care of everything. You will go from happiness to happiness. And even in this life, you see, everybody enjoys a kind person. So naturally you have many friends, people like you, and you have fewer and fewer problems. So I think to make one's kind heart main practice, I think is most important. And then of course, with calm abiding, it becomes very easy to sustain, to maintain the kind heart. So the less you have thoughts, the less you have agitation, it's easy, to be a kind person and to maintain that state. And it's so, how to say, it makes your life you feel your life is so precious, so rich and so deep. And all the, because again, loving kindness, you see, it opens your heart. So you discover new depths, you see, in your being, So I think that's best. Thank you very much for coming. Wishing you a good night. Bye-bye.